Yattic analysis and Galois representations, and maybe tell us a little more how it connects with Colonel Zestner.
Okay. So what do we want to study exactly? So we are interested in a representation of the absolute Galois group of Q. So V here is some finite dimensional vector space. Over some finite extension of QP. And so we don't want to look at all of these representations, but we want to look at what Fontaine and Maisel call geometric. So rho v is a geometric. If the following holds, so you want that the restriction to GQP is Dora, something that I defined yesterday. So rho v restricted to GQP is Dora. And you want that rho v restricted to GQL, or L different from G, is non-ramified except for finitely many PL. For a finite number of L. Okay, so this is a definition which is due to a Fontaine measure. And as I explained yesterday, if you have a representation that comes from geometry, then it is geometric. But this is a very deep theorem of many people. So representations coming from geometry are geometric. And Fontaine-Maeser's conjecture is that the converse is true for Fontaine-Maeser. So they tell you that if you have a rho v like this, which is irreducible, and geometric, then it should come from geometry. So this is a conjecture. So coming from geometry means that it is you can cut it into inside the etal cohomology of some algebraic variety. And so it's a very the first time you see this conjecture, it's quite startling, because if you look at the condition you put on the representation, you have the impression that you could move this representation continuously. But if it comes from geometry, it means that it is going to come from an algebraic variety over Q, then you have only enumerable a set of possibilities, and you cannot move it continuously. So it's very striking in some way. But anyway, it's a conjecture. And now, if we believe in this conjecture, and if we also believe in what Langlands tells us, it means that mean the following. So to a rho v like this, you can attach an L function which is defined by a product over all primes of some Euler factors. And so if you believe in Fontaine-Maeser plus Langlands, to this rho v should correspond a pi v, some automorphic representation. And maybe algebraic automorphic representation. And to this one, we also know how to attach some L function, and this one we actually understand thanks to work of Jacquet Langlands and Goldman-Jacquet, for example. And so Langlands tells you that there should be such a correspondence with equality of L functions. So it means that well, if this is true, then we understand this kind of L functions because we understand this one. Okay, so but now automorphic representations, it means that it is a representation of something like a GLV of the Abel group of Q, which is some product, I mean restricted product, GLV of R times GLD of QL over all L. And so what you get from there, well, you get first some rho VL, which is just the restriction of rho V to GQL on one side. And on this side, you get a pi VL, which is a representation of this GLD of QL. And local Langlands correspondence is supposed to make these two things correspond. And so this is all very good for L different from P. So for L not equals to P, then this works. Meaning that you actually can attach to such a thing, what we call the representation of the Baldwin group, and the local Langlands correspondence attached to this some IVL. And when, I mean, every time we know how to construct to such a IV, a rho V, basically every time we know how to do that, we know also that the local thing corresponds to the local thing. So that's all very good. But what about L equals P? And so why does this work for L not P? It's because the Galois group GL, sorry, GQL is essentially an L group, and the GL of V that we have here, it's essentially a pro-P group. So it means that if you have a continuous map from this one to this one, not much is going to survive. So there is only a finite amount of things that is going to come out. But this is not true for L equals P, because this is a pro-P group, this is essentially a pro-P group, and so you have a lot of possible representations. Okay, so to explain what is the problem for L equals P, I have to remind you things about the RAM representation that I said yesterday. So let me remind you that yesterday, if you had a V, you had this fontaine occurrence of category to which to a gamma representation there was some phi gamma module attached, and I had a diagram of module that I'm going to write in the opposite, well, maybe I put it in the same sense as in my notes, otherwise I'm going to get lost. So I had a diagram like this, a D dagger inside a D inside a blah blah, and inside here I had some dn, inside here a delta n, and here I had maps to something called d if n plus, and this n n. I'm going to recall you some of these things, and Fontaine equivalence of category tells you that our V can be completely constructed from this phi gamma module. And in fact, this figure module can be reconstructed from this one or from this one. So this was Kedlaya, and this was what we proved with Cher-Bonnier. And so I told you that on this part of the diagram, I had a nabla, which is a connection on all of these things. So nabla is a connection. And I remind you that we decided that V is the RAM. If the connection is trivial on d if n plus where I invert t, which is an, it was so some ln double t vector space of finite dimension. So what does it mean geometrically? It means that you have this module here, which is a module that lives over some kind of annulus like this. And so you have a connection, so you have a differential module over this annulus here. And this iota n, as I explained to you, was the localization to p to the nth root of unity minus 1. So what it says is, it says that your representation is Durham if this differential module that you have is trivial when you look at it around one point. Okay? And it's all going to be trivial at all other p to the nth root of unity, which is a sequence of elements that converge to the border of this disk. Okay, so that's what we had yesterday. And from there, we defined a D-Durham, which generates, so such that ln tensor D-Durham is a space of differential of all of horizontal sections. And so this D-Durham here comes with a filtration. So that's one of the things that we have. And so that's what I explained yesterday. But what I want to explain is that we have something much better. Meaning we have a theorem that tells you that not only you have local solutions like this, but you have global solutions. But in order to have global solutions, you have to make some cover of your annulus. And so
this is assuming that V
is the RAM, yes. Yeah. Now you may assume that V is the RAM, and I want to put some extra structure on this D the RAM. So what is exactly going on? So there is a construction of Berger, which goes like this. So assume that V is the RAM again, and you define W to be the set of elements Z in delta where you invert T. So maybe I should remind you that our T is log of 1 plus T. And it's a thing that gets zero at all these P to the nth root of unity minus 1. So you take the set of elements like this, such that when you localize them at the P to the nth root of unity, then they land into the submodule spanned by D-Durham for all n for which this has a meaning, for all n big enough. So what you prove easily is that this W is an R module of the rank of the same rank as D, of rank D of V. And now there is something that happens. So it still comes with a phi and a nabla. But there is something that happens is that because the nabla is zero on D-Durham, in fact, what happens is that if you look at nabla of V, then this is going to land inside T times W. Nabla applied to W goes into T times W, which means that you can divide your connection here by T. And so you define delta to be 1 over T nabla. So it's still a connection on W, but now this nabla on coefficients is equal to 1 plus T d over dt, And so it has no more singularity at all. Before, there was all the singularity of log of 1 plus t in this differential equation. And so you are exactly in the realm of what we call periodic differential equations. So this is the realm of periodic differential equations. So these were extremely carefully studied by, for example, Crystal and Mempoot. People tell you is that, well, if you have such a differential equation, then if you look at the space of horizontal section, then there is some horizontal section up to making a metal power of this. And so what it means exactly is that it tells you that there are, solutions in something of the following type. So let me write it and then I explain. So you have to add the logarithm of your uniformizer, log of t, and this f prime over r is a finite etal power. So this, this R was a union of some Rn, and the Rn is exactly the space of functions that are analytic on something like that. Okay? So the R is what we call the Robarin. And it's a space of functions that are analytic on some annulus. And the outside of the annulus is fixed, is 1, and this one gets smaller and smaller. And so what do you get from that? Well, you define dpst of V to be the space of horizontal section in here. And so what does it come with? So it comes with the following thing. So you have a phi, because you have a phi everywhere. It comes with some monodromy operator, which corresponds to viewing log t as a new variable here, so which is the different derivative with respect to log t. And you can verify that n phi is equal to p phi n. But it comes also with an action of GQP, but which factors for a finite portion. Portion which I call GK, let's say. So this K is going to be a finite extension of QP. And so where does this GQP action come from? Well, it is built from the action of gamma that you had everywhere. You have the phi gamma module plus the action of this finite gamma group here. And then it comes with a filtration on K tensor dpst of V, which is the same thing as A tensor D the ram of V. Okay, so now what is the situation? If you look at this picture here, what you have on this side, you're going to have a representation of GLD of QP. And this representation allows you to recover this part of the data. So this part is covered by the local Langlands correspondence, classical local Langlands correspondence. But now, if you look at the way things go, you see that if you actually want to recover the representation, you also need this filtration. If you need, if you have this filtration, then you can do exactly what we did in the other direction, and you recover the phi gamma module, and so you recover the representation. So if you actually want to find rho vp, well, there is the filtration which is missing, okay? So the question is, where is this filtration hidden? I mean, how can we recover the filtration? On the GLD of 2p psi. And why do we want that? Well, we want that because so if we want to prove instance of this global Langlands correspondence, we need two things. We need to know that if we start from a algebraic automorphic representation, then we can actually get a Galois representation. And then, so that's supposed to be the easy sense of the correspondence, except that it's not that easy, as people who work in the field know. And, but once you are there, and if you start from a Galois representation, you have to be able to guess what the global representation is going to be somehow. And where to find it. And for that, you need to know precisely, you need to be able to recover exactly the Galois representation attached to GQP, because that's the part that knows the most about the Galois representation. And so you cannot content yourself with this data, it doesn't give enough information. So you need to be able to recover the filtration. So Breuil's idea was that, well, this is something that looks completely p-adic. So it means that we should look at representation of GLD of QP on some p-adic space, but with p-adic topology. Okay? Here, the representation that you have are on some complex space or any kind of vector space, but there is no topology on the space. It's a discrete topology that you use here. Okay, so let's see what we actually get. So what we are led to is, we are led to the study of p-adic continuous representations of GLD of QP. So I should mention maybe that there was a lot of work done by Schneider and Teitelbaum for the study of the general framework of what kind of representation we should consider. And so now I will tell you what happens in real life. So, and I will explain, for d equals 2, everything is nice, and that's what the story I'm going to tell. Everything is okay. And for d bigger than 3, well, we don't know anything yet, so it's still a complete mystery. But as you will see, I mean, everything works so well for d equals 2 that it is very hard to believe that nothing is going to work for d bigger than 3. But still, we have no clue of what should be the right framework. Okay, so what kind of representation do we want to consider? So from now on, G is GL2 of QP. Okay, and so there are some global considerations that tells you what kind of proposition of GL2 or QP you should consider. By global consideration, I mean when you look at the cohomology of towers of similar varieties, you can see what kind of proposition of GLD or QP are coming there. And so it tells you that you should look at unitary admissible, so I'm going to define this. Reps. So unitary means what? So it means it's a Banach space. So it's a L Banach space. So it's a P-adding Banach space together with a continuous action of G. And then unitary means that this action stabilizes the unit ball. So with unit ball stable. And the admissibility condition is a finiteness condition, which tells you that if you look at pi naught mod p to the n pi naught, and you look at the fixed point under any open subgroup, then this should be a finite module. Finite for all k inside G open subgroup. So that's the admissibility condition. Well, OL is a finite, if you prefer, it's finite length. But here, my OL is a finite extension of ZP.
So it's a finite set.
It's a finite set, even. But finite length is maybe better. But still, it's a finite set. And moreover, you want also to restrict yourself to representations that have a central character, plus a central character. So meaning that A is 0, 0, A, acts through a scalar, which we call omega-tai of A. And the category of representation you want to consider is exactly the same. So the pi as above. But in fact, it happens that you are going to land into something smaller than this admissibility condition, which is that pi naught mod p to the n pi naught is in fact finite length. Over OL of G. So this is a little bit stronger than the admissibility condition. So now the question is, how can you construct elements of this category of representation? And more precisely, you start from a two-dimensional representation of the Galois group, and you want to be able to construct such an object, okay? And so there is a recipe. When I discovered it, I was very surprised that it works. I'll tell you why. So I remind you that on this part, diagram here, these things in fact are sheaves over ZP, and they are equivariant under the semigroup P plus, which is ZP minus 0. 0, 1. And so what we are going to do is construct some sheaf over P1, which are equivalent under the action of G. So So the construction goes as follows. You start from a D, which is an etal D gamma module over E. So our V corresponds to some D. How does it work? So one good thing about this Fontaine equivalence of categories is that, as I explained to you, you can just forget about their representation and only speak about phi gamma modules. Okay, so you pick the phi gamma modules that corresponds to V. And you also pick a character delta from QP star to L star, some character, continuous character. And what you are going to do, you are going to construct a G equivariant sheaf so it's U goes to D cross U so U is an open compact subset of P1 so on P1 of QP so P1 is P1 of QP and the action of G on P1 of QP is the usual action A, B CD acting on X is equal to AX plus B over CX plus D. Okay, so how do you construct this sheaf? Well, what you do, well, you want that when you restrict it to ZP, what you get is a sheaf that you started with. Okay, so you started with a sheaf, so this should be D with the P plus action. So that's one of the requirements. And how do you construct it? Well, the idea is the following. So you are going to translate in terms of phi gamma module some very standard action of GL2 of QP, which is the following. So the idea is translate in terms of phi gamma module. In exactly the same way as I did last time to translate periodic functional analysis in terms of the hovering or things like that. Okay. So in terms of figure module, the following action, so action, natural action, on something that I called the dual of B delta star, dual of B delta, and B delta is a space of function from QP to L, which are continuous, and at infinity, they are almost equal to delta, so you want that delta of x, phi of 1 over x, is continuous at 0. I mean, can be prolonged, continued as a continuous function on 0. So on the dual of this space, you have an actual action, which is just given by, if you have a measure mu, an element of the dual, you divide, it translates again by ABCD to be given by the following formula, delta of CX plus B, phi AX plus B, CX plus B. So anyone who already saw a modular form will not be surprised by this kind of formula. Okay, so the idea is exactly that. You take these formulas here and you translate them in terms of figure and module. And now you notice that P1 is a union of two copies of ZP. Glued along ZP star just by inverting x goes to 1 over x. And so if you want to describe this sheaf, it's enough to describe its cross section to ZP. Ah yeah, and you have that, and you also have that G is generated by P plus and the element W, which is 0, 1, 1, 0. So in order to describe the sheaf, it's sufficient to describe its restriction to ZP, but we already did, together with the action of P plus, and also to describe the action of W on the restriction to ZP star. If you have that, you have a complete description of your sheaf. Okay, and so the formula is the following, W of Z. So as I say, it's a mere translation of this formula here. Okay, so I'm writing it, and I'm telling you that this formula is useless for anything you want to prove, but it's good that it exists. So some I in ZP star mod P to the n. So how is this formula obtained? Well, you have some integral to perform, okay? And you go back to first year calculus, and what you do is you cut off, you are going to write some Riemann sums. And so the Riemann sums are exactly these ones. And what you do is, you can rewrite everything in terms of phi, gamma, and so on. And in order to obtain this formula, what you have to do at some point is to replace 1 over x by its Taylor expansion to the first order, and that's exactly the formula that you would get. So there is nothing mysterious in this formula. What is mysterious is that there is actually a limit. When I first wrote it down, I could not believe this was going to converge to any sixth sensible, and it took me some time to get convinced it actually works. So once you have this sheaf here, you can look at the space of global section, and because your sheaf is equivalent under the action of G, this comes with an action of G. And there is a central character, which is just delta, composed with a determinant. So now, so are you happy with the result? Well, the answer is not at all, because you are trying to do something related to local Lagrange correspondence. And local Lagrange correspondence should match representation of GL2 of QP to two-dimensional objects. And here I never told you that my object was two-dimensional. So in fact, this works for any figure of youth. So that's one of the reasons why I was very unhappy that this actually converges. I mean, I was sure it would not converge. So what is the catch here? So the catch is that your D is finite dimensional over E. And I remind you that we had an exact sequence like this, goes to E, goes to C of ZP, goes to zero. So if you look at this exact sequence of topological vector spaces, this one is a Barnard space, exactly what we want to have. But this one is not a Barnard space at all, it's a dual of a Barnard space. So it's topologically very different from a Barnard space. Okay? And so in order to get objects that interest you, you need this to split in something that looks like this. Okay? And so if you have a definition, you say that D delta is G compatible if you can actually split this in the following way. So if you have some exact sequence like this, so you have two representation of GL2 of 2P coming. And here you have a star, where pi of D and pi prime of D are elements in the category that interest you. Okay, so one necessary condition for this to work is that your delta here is a unitary, because you want unitary representation, so you want delta to take value in OL star, so that's a trivial condition. But if you want to be able to construct representations that actually interest you, you need some kind of condition like that. And the theorem is the following. So you take D, a enthalpy gamma module over E, and you assume that it is irreducible. Then you have the following result. So the first thing is that if D is dimension 1 of rank 1, or dimension 1, because we are over a field, then D delta is G compatible for any delta. And in fact, the representation that you are going to recover from this construction are exactly the representation that you started with here that gave you the formula you wanted. So this case is not very interesting. The second case is more interesting. So if D is dimension 2, now that's the point that there exists a unique character delta, which we call delta D. And this character delta D is just x norm x to the minus 1 determinant of D. So determinant of D is a one-dimensional phi gamma module to which is attached a one-dimensional gamma representation, and by a local class field theory is attached a character of 2p star. So that's what you mean by that. Such that D delta D is here, is G compatible. And so in that case, what you get is that pi prime of D. So you have two representations of G that comes in, but in fact they are the twist of each other. So you have that pi prime of D is equal to pi of D tensored with delta D minus 1 composed the determinant. So basically in this exact sequence you have twice here the representation that you want, and it's dual that appear. And the third thing is that if D is of dimension bigger than 3, so if of D is bigger than 3, then it's never G compatible. So we are saved, right? Because it only works in dimension 2. So that's a good thing. So let me make some remarks about this theorem. So you get a correspondence, V goes to D, so this is Fontaine, and then goes to pi of D, which we are going to call pi of V from now on. Okay? And so this is some correspondence, which is exactly the periodic local Lovelace correspondence. So it's periodic local Lovelace. So I should say that the recipe which is here also works in dimension 2 if your D is not irreducible. And so this triadic Coppola-Langlands extends also to non-irreducible objects. So that's the first thing. And now let me tell you something about the proof. So in case of dimension 1, the proof is very easy because it's basically a translation of how the construction arose. So that's no problem. For dimension 1, okay, easy. Yeah, and I should say that what you get in that case are things that are built from one-dimensional things. Okay, so.
And so pi of D is what dimension?
The pi of D is operational G, so it's infinite dimensional.
It's a dimension of what?
It's infinite dimensional. It's operational of GL2 of QP. So you start from a Gamma representation of dimension 2, and you get the operational of GL2 of QP, which is infinite dimensional. Okay? But your Gamma representation could very well be the extension of two characters. And the recipe I give you still works. And it still gives you representation of GL2 of QP. But this representation of GL2 of QP is not going to be reducible anymore. Is going to be an extension of two things that comes from the dimension one case.
The pi and pi prime?
No. I mean the pi of D here. The pi of D itself. So dimension one is easy, but for dimension two, this is quite hard. So in dimension two, I have no direct proof of this statement. So what you have to do, you have to use some special D. And these special Ds are exactly the ones that correspond to Durham representations on which it appears. So there was a G of QP action, and you want this to factor through an abelian quotient. So some special Ds corresponding to the Durham representation. And then you have to use some analytic continuation argument to prove for the rest of the cases, which you cannot handle, so plus analytic continuation. And now, the unicity of delta D in dimension 2 and the fact that this is never G-compatible in dimension bigger than 3, this is due to Bascunas. So the rest, so unicity of delta D is due to Bascunas. So it's a corollary of what he wrote. And I should mention that this paper is not so easy and not so small. It's 120 pages long, so it's not. So it's quite complicated to prove that there is nothing fishy going on with this representation, with this correspondence. Okay, so what do you do with that? Huh? So you want to link this periodic local correspondence to the classical one. So for this, I need a notion. Say that it is locally algebraic if the following holds. So if you look at the map G equals to GV, then this is locally a polynomial. Locally polynomial on G. And so it means that it is locally polynomial. So if your small g is a, b, c, d, you want that it is locally a polynomial in a, b, c, d, and the determinant ad minus bc inverse. So that are the coordinates of your group as an algebraic group. And you say that it is locally analytic if this is locally analytic. And locally analytic is only in the entries of the matrix A, B, C, D. You don't need the determinant. And so you get the subspace of locally algebraic element, which is inside the subspace of locally analytic element. And this is inside I of V. And it's quite easy to verify that these two subspaces are in fact stable under the action of G. So this gives you some sub-representation of this big representation I of V. Yeah, maybe I did not stress enough that this local Langmuir correspondence works for any, I mean, you can start from any representation here. You don't need to impose anything like Durham or anything. Okay? You can start from anything.
Of rank 2.
Of rank 2, yes. I could do it of rank 3, I would be very pleased. So now the question is, how can you recognize the Durham representations using this correspondence? And the theorem is the following. So you have locally algebraic vectors. If and only if G is Durham, but with two distinct project weights. Let's say A bigger than B, A is strictly smaller than B, so A and B are two integers in that case. And if this is the case, so that's the first statement, and the second statement is that if this is the case, you can actually say what is what are the locally algebraic vectors. So let me remind you that because our representation is Durham, there is a DPST of V attached to it, and I told you that this DPST of V is exactly the kind of object to which the usual local Langmuir correspondence attaches something. So this is obtained from the usual local Langmuir correspondence. But here you have locally algebraic vectors, and this one is locally constant. And so, odd state weights are encoded in what follows. So you have to twist by the character determinant of A and take the tensor product by C B minus A minus 1. So where this one, it means the symmetric power of the standard representation of dimension 2. So if you prefer, it's also the natural action on polynomial of homogeneous polynomial of degree exactly. Okay, so this is how the periodic local Langmuir correspondence encodes the classical one. So it can be viewed as a big refinement of the classical one.
What's the classical one?
What do you mean the classical? That's the one, well, in that case, it's due to Tunnel. So the classical Langmuir correspondence, where you have objects on both sides.
But you mean also this for periodic or global?
No, it's a local.
You're talking about local.
Local. It's just a purely local one.
Okay,
so let me give some remarks about this theorem.
So before you raise, so what happens if you have if D is an extension of two irreducible two-dimensionals?
Well, if D is an extension of two irreducible, what you get is a pi of D, which is an extension of two things of dimension one, like that come from dimension one. And I told you that this.
No, in the case that this is an extension of two. two-dimensional one, figure model.
Yes, so if you have something like some character.
No.
What?
Not, you don't have characters. I mean, D is an extension of D1 by D2.
Yes, D1 and D2 are characters.
No, two-dimensional.
D is an extension of D1 by D2.
And D1 and D2 are two-dimensional figure.
Ah, these two? Okay, so then sometimes...
Can you construct an extension of representations?
Usually not. Only if your representation is... Okay. So what Pascunas tells you is that... So assume you have something like that, D1, D, then D2. Goes to zero. Okay. So Pascunas is going to tell you that you can have a non-trivial extension of the corresponding representation of GL2 of QP if and only if D1 is equal to D2. Okay. And even if it is the case, then not all extensions are going to give you representation of GL2 of QP. So it's quite subtle. So how do you prove this kind of statement? Well, the first thing you do, I mean, it's quite difficult to attack directly the locally algebraic vectors. So the first thing you do is to compute the locally analytic vectors. And the locally analytic vectors, what you prove is that if d delta is g compatible, then this implies that if you look at the sub, you have a sub sheaf of D cross U, which is stable under the action of P1. So it's G equivariant sub sheaf. And once you are there, it's not difficult to construct a G equivariant sheaf from there just by density or by continuity. And the theorem is that in that case, if you look at the global section, well, they know about the locally analytic vectors. So you have a P of by V an, and the kernel is P prime of V an dual. As I told you, this P prime is basically pi of V, but twisted by a character. So it means that you have a description of the local analytic vectors instead of the figure you started with. So that's the first step. The second step is that what does it mean for a vector to be locally algebraic? It means that it is going to be killed by differential operators of a certain order. Okay. So it means that V is in P of the algebra if and only if V is killed by a certain ideal of the enveloping algebra by finite dimension ideal. U of GL2. And so if you know the action of GL2, then you have a big chance to be able to actually compute the locally algebraic vectors. Okay? And in fact, so that's what my student Dospinescu did, computed this action. So I could never believe when he started his thesis that there would be a formula at all. And so, I mean, this theorem I proved, but my proof is really horrible. And now, because he actually was able to compute this action, now you have a very natural proof. It is clear that it's a right proof of this statement. So once you have, once you know the action of the enveloping algebra, then it's not such a mystery of how to prove the first part of the statement. But for the second part, it's another matter. So that gives you the first part. For the second part, well, there are two cases. And the most difficult cases is if dPst of V, when you look at it, the action of GQP on it, it does not factor through the abelian quotient. In which case, it means that this one is going to be a super cuspidal representation of GL2 of QP. So if the loop is super cuspidal, then unfortunately, I don't know how to compute what would be needed to prove that you are matching with what you want. And so what you do is that what you prove is that this part here only depends on this and not on the filtration that you can put on it. And because it does not depend on the filtration, well, you are free to choose a filtration. So what you do, you choose a filtration that corresponds to a modular form, and then you use some global argument due to Emerton. So, which is, so, and you choose a filtration. Plus global arguments of Emerton. So there is still some kind of very disagreeable thing that you have something which is purely local, but there is not not a purely local proof to state. That's okay. And the last thing I want to say is that this theorem here, I mean the second part here, is exactly what you need. So exactly what is needed for the proof of the Fontaine-Maeser conjecture in dimension 2. Of Fontaine-Maeser in dimension 2. So that's work by Kissin and Everton. And to be completely fair, I should say that it is not in all cases. They have some cases that they cannot treat. So for most cases. So, in particular, this only works for things attached to modular forms. Things attached to modular forms, they have the properties that if you look at the complex conjugation, the determinant is going to be minus one. So that's only what we call the even representation. And for in the odd case, if you have odd state weights which are distinct, like here, what Fontaine-Maeser predicts you is that if you are in that case, in fact, V does not exist. And this has been proved by Calegari, but not using that because it does not exist. So it's some completely different method. Okay, so I stop here.
Any questions?
Yeah. With this construction, assuming that PV algebra is non-zero, is PV algebraic or PV analytic dense in Python?
Yeah, so if PV analytic is always dense in Python. PVN is always dense. And PV alg, if it is non-zero, it is dense also. In that case, there is the case where your representation is not irreducible, where something fishy can happen.
It's only about GL2 QP, right?
Yes. Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, for GL2F, so there are some work by Pascunas and Breuer and Pascunas, who give the impression that the situation is going to be a complete mess. But there are some recent results that makes me hope that it's not going to be so messy after all. But still, I mean, I have no definite statement to make about that case. The only thing that I know is that this, because of this work of Roy and Pascunas, the situation looks very, very different. But, I mean, I cannot believe that it works so well here. It's going to be a complete disaster in general. So one has to find the truth. But,
Any other questions?
But maybe within 1 year there will be something to be said about J2, I hope.
Well, let's thank Pierre for two great lectures.